JWST has discovered something never seen before, and it's in my absolute favorite celestial location, the Orion Nebula. This discovery has astronomers very excited, but also very puzzled. What's been found is a new class of celestial object called JuMBOs, and they're blurring the line between how stars form and how planets form. Could there be new physics to be discovered from this? Let's get into it. JuMBOs, aka Jupiter Mass Binary Objects, are just that. They're planet-like objects that have similar masses to our big gassy boy Jupiter, and they come in pairs, hence binary. Although, on occasion, they have been found in a throuple. And these pairs of planets, they just hang out in space by themselves, mutually orbiting each other. They don't have a star to supervise them. They are rogue. And their existence really blurs the line between how stars form and how planets form. But to understand why this discovery blurs that line of star and planet formation, we need context. The researchers, Samuel Pearson and Mark McCorrion of the European Space Agency, found these JuMBOs in their JWST observations while they were initially looking for isolated objects in the planetary mass domain below 13 Jupiter masses. So they were already searching for rogue planets with no stars inside the center of the Orion Nebula. The reason why they were searching for rogue planets with masses below 13 times the mass of Jupiter was to investigate something called the initial mass function. The initial mass function tells us about the distribution of stars with different masses born within a large group of stars, like those born from a big nebula like the Orion Nebula, for example, or even entire galaxies. Generally, there are much fewer massive stars born compared to stars with much lower masses. However, this relationship isn't well explored at very low masses. So that's what Pearson and McCorrion were looking at in particular. In their search, they found 540 such rogue planets. Now this is quite impressive to me because gassy objects with masses below 13 times the mass of Jupiter do not have enough mass to ignite any sort of fusion. For example, gassy objects with masses greater than 80 times the mass of Jupiter, aka stars, they will ignite hydrogen fusion in their cores. Even brown dwarf stars with masses between 13 and 80 times the mass of Jupiter will ignite deuterium fusion. But below 13 times the mass of Jupiter, no fusion can occur. There's just not enough mass and not enough pressure. And since there's no fusion, these objects are quite cool and faint. But when they're relatively young, say within a million years old, they're still relatively warm and bright in infrared wavelengths, perfect for JWST to spot. And the trapezium cluster in the Orion Nebula, which is where they looked, is the ideal place to search for these objects for four reasons. Number one, it's quite close. The Orion Nebula is the closest large star-forming region to us. Number two, it's a relatively young star cluster, so those isolated planetary mass objects that they're looking for will also be young and easier to spot for JWST. Number three, it's located outside of the galactic plane, meaning there won't be much stuff in the way contaminating the view. And number four, the dense nebula behind the cluster minimizes contamination from stars further away in the background called field stars, because they might look like imposter planets at first look. So with good science and the ideal instrument for the job, they found 540 rogue planets in the nearby trapezium cluster. But they were shocked to find 40 pairs and two throuples. So to understand why they were shocked about finding so many pairs, we need to introduce another trend we see across stars with different masses, and that is the multiplicity fraction. The multiplicity fraction is essentially the percentage of stars of a certain mass that are born with at least one stellar buddy or companion. For the most massive and hot stars, O and B type stars, the multiplicity fraction is almost 100%. So almost 100% of massive hot O and B type stars will come in at least a pair. For stars like the Sun, that reduces to about 50 to 60%, so 50 to 60% of stars like the Sun come in at least a pair. And for brown dwarf stars, it's around 15% for the highest mass brown dwarf stars and 8% for the lowest mass brown dwarf stars. So as you can see, as you decrease in mass, the multiplicity fraction also decreases. So it would be safe to assume that the multiplicity fraction for even lower masses, like these planetary mass objects Pearson and McCorrion are looking at, should have a multiplicity fraction close to zero. And that's exactly what they said in their paper. But instead, they found that around 9% of their sample of planetary mass objects came in pairs, completely going against a trend that spans across three orders of magnitude of mass. That's pretty substantial. So what are the implications of this? Like I mentioned at the beginning of the video, this blurs the line between the formation of stars and the formation of planets, and could potentially result in new physics being explored. So how does this blur that line? Well, there's a pretty clear line between rocky planets like Earth and stars, but that line gets a little fuzzy for planets like Jupiter that have very similar compositions to brown dwarf stars, but different masses. Sure, single gassy planets can form within the gassy disk surrounding a young forming star, and then get ejected or yeeted for multiple reasons, left to wander space with no stellar supervision. That's fine, but we've never seen, let alone thought it was even remotely possible, for a gravitationally bound pair of gassy planets to form within the disk of a young forming star and then get ejected or yeeted, but then stay gravitationally bound. That's just weird. Like, that hasn't even been modeled before because it's so outlandish of an idea. And that isn't what they think has happened here. Alternatively, these JuMBOs could form in star-like ways, forming mutually at the same time from the same clump of gas in a large nebula. But the usual processes behind star formation don't seem to work at such low masses. So, Pearson and McCorrin suggest that new formation mechanisms must come into play at these low masses. This could be very exciting. We're learning more and more about the universe, which is awesome, but we should take this publication cautiously for now, since it hasn't gone through the peer review process as yet. This paper is one of two that have been submitted to the journal Nature, so we'll wait and see how it goes through the peer review process. But I think it's pretty solid and presents a good argument for this new discovery, especially since they state that they have additional observing time with JWST coming up early next year to do a spectroscopic follow-up of these objects. And spectroscopy always provides a clearer picture of what's going on, so I'm excited to see what comes up next out of that study. Either way, JuMBOs, welcome to the celestial catalogue.